Thanks. Thanks very much for having me. Thanks to the University of Georgia for inviting me. I came away from this morning from a delightful conversation with your faculty and students, so it's really nice and exciting place to be. Just in terms of who I am and my own scholarship, I referenced this before at our morning meeting, but I come from a place where my master's degree is actually in English literature. And so you'll see in my own work, I can't help but pull from the humanities and that type of thinking. I was at Northeastern University for my master's, and I used this example before, but Herb Sussman, who I worked with there on the first day of class, said, "We're going to read Foucault and everything in relation to Foucault." And it was an amazing indoctrination into sort of the Foucauldian world, and you'll see that I can't help but think that way, so that very much influences what I do. And then in my doctoral work and my current scholarship, I look a lot at higher education. I came out of a program, a department that had higher education as a program, and so I look at faculty work practices. So that's where I'll pull some of my examples from here. And hence the title, which deals with higher education and inquiry and the government of things. So it was actually Ryan Gildersleeve, who I referenced earlier as well, who's at the University of Denver, who tagged me with this thing that he says, "Well, Aaron Kuntz is a materialist methodologist." I'm still not entirely sure what that means, but if it means anything, I'm very interested in how practices articulate in the material world, and practice, even how we think, can be materially inflected. And this notion of the government of things, I should say, comes from Foucault. I was asked earlier about new materialism, and I keep asking myself, what exactly is it that's new about new materialism? Not in the sense that it's not new, but how has it shifted in relation to materialist thinking? And Foucault has this lovely notion about the government of things. And for Foucault, things are relational, right? Things happen in relation. There are no discrete objects unto themselves. So you might hear when you, or see when you're reading about new materialism or think theory, right? Bennett's work and the like, they're talking about this relational way of thinking. In the construction of material, the material world, as a system of relations. Well, hence my question, what's so new about new materialism? Because Foucault talked about that. But remember, I'm indoctrinated, right? I'm just sort of repeating what, in many ways, the way of thinking that I grew up with, kind of academically speaking. So I want to talk today, and I'm going to sort of move back and forth between talking, and there is some types of elements that I'm going to read because I want to get the wording right. But I'm going to talk about how we make sense within our contemporary moment. And I want to locate that sense-making as an extension and also playing into qualitative research. This is one of the areas that I teach, qualitative inquiry as well as philosophy of education. So I want to think about sense-making as productive in the sense that it makes possible ways of being and ways of practicing. And it also makes possible particular ways of being governed as individuals and subjects and relations. So these ways of governing impact our daily practices of living to such an extent that it manages possibilities for who we are, sort of our subjecthood, and what we might become. You'll see in critical materialism, they talk a lot about becomings because, as I'll note, they move beyond the humanist subject. They try to move beyond this discrete object. So, These ways of governing are decidedly material, and they're not abstractions. They don't exist just in the ideal. So this is sort of how Foucault is structuring this, and we'll get to Deleuze in a little bit. So I look at factory work practices, so that's what I'm going to pull from. I thought I'd give an overview of how I'm going to talk. I'm going to work through a series of anecdotes that I think are, one is kind of fun, and then one looks at how it articulates in the University of Alabama. I'm going to talk a little bit about extractive logic and humanist subjects. I write often about a logic of extraction, and sometimes I worry that that's how traditional forms of research operate, through extractive logic. You extract out of context. And the notion of the humanist subject aligns with that extractive possibility because humanist subjects are discrete unto themselves, and they are a priori. They come before the experience, right? Then I'm going to talk about relational logic, and this gets into the new materialism, and Deleuze's notion of the individual. And then we'll talk about it in relation to faculty work. So here I'm going to make some claims. I thought I'd just sort of get them out there. Conventional forms of inquiry extending from a logic of extraction, again, relying on representational systems, these a priori subjects, as well as extractable knowledges. I'm going to talk about critically materialist inquiry operating on relational logics, relations with and within, that you no longer talk about subjects, but you talk about subjectivities in the making. And you talk about materially productive contexts. These are sort of what comes from the new materialist bent. However, because I'm sort of skeptical, I think healthfully skeptical, I want to say that both these extractive and relational orientations make possible select forms of governing. They're dangerous in different ways. So Foucault has this great quote that you've probably seen or done over and over again. It's not that things are right or wrong, it's that they're dangerous, right? So there's a tagline to that quote where he says, because they're dangerous, then we always have something to do, right? We have work, sort of what Foucault is saying. So I want to say that they're dangerous in different ways. And the last one is never underestimate the power of food or representations of food. And this is going to lead into the anecdote with which I work. Okay. So I'm going to begin with working through two anecdotes that I think deal with this notion of representational value and material effects, and they link to those first two bullets, the liberal humanist subject and the individual in specific, specifically. The first anecdote has to do with food, the second one with faculty work at my university, and I'm going to try to make the attempt that they're actually not, it's not that different, even though they might seem so on the surface. I think they're bound by an interesting play on how to assess and represent value. They're also bound by a seemingly universal star system, I'll get into that, wherein the more stars one receives, the better one is seen to be, something we maybe all learned in kindergarten, right? That's more stars are good. And that starred representation then corresponds to some element of identity value. And then I'm gonna say that they're also bound, these two anecdotes, by their inevitably material effects. That is, they make possible select practices. All right, so to begin, I don't know if people are aware or do the Michelin Guide. The Michelin Guide is this great ranking of restaurants that the Brothers Michelin put together. It started in 1900 and has a really sort of interesting history. So it started in 1900, and the goal, as I understand it, was they wanted to increase car travel in France. So they came up with these maps around restaurants. Why did they want to increase car travel in France? Well, Michelin, they sell tires, right? So they're going to, they need people to be on the roads to wear down their tires so that they can sell, they can continue the Michelin's trade. So, and began as this roadmap of France that highlighted restaurants and hotels and was updated periodically. And then about 25 or 26 years later, they instituted the star system based on an anonymous review of restaurants carried out by a team of Michelin agents, which were actually kind of qualitative researchers, right? They went into the restaurants and they came up with a star system. I hope you can read it. And this is how they have it. One star, it's a very good restaurant in its own category. Two stars, excellent cooking, worth a detour. And three stars, excellent cuisine, worth a special trip unto itself, right? And that has not changed since the 1920s. As an aside, this has nothing to do with my presentation, but it's interesting. During World War II, the Allied powers used the Michelin Guide to plan their invasion because they had the best maps. Isn't that kind of interesting? So they used the Michelin Guide to provide, they had the most detailed information for the foreign armies, which again, never underestimate the power of fine food. Right? They were so good, Michelin was, at creating the maps that the Allied powers asked for them. So there's this fine and storied history regarding the guide. It's initially produced to provoke automobile travel and sell tires. It's used as an aid for military invasion. And of course, it guides readers to fine restaurants the world over. Today, receiving a star can make or break a restaurant. Right? There are very material implications for this. It can establish or destroy a career. On very rare occasions, Michelin will remove a star from a restaurant, the fallout severe. Right? At the same time, there's this interesting resistive quality among restaurateurs who the restaurant owners refuse or they ask to opt out of the Michelin Guide process. Some restaurant owners refuse a star rating because it brings undue expectation to the establishment. Patrons come to expect too much when they go to a two-star restaurant. It's interesting because the food then has become more than the restaurant. Here, representation exceeds the immediate material context. So they say, no, we don't want, please don't give us a star. So they ask not to be assigned a star, or if they must be assigned a star, to be assigned the lowest star possible. So this could be read, I think, as designing a strategic miscalculation, right? Please miscalculate us. An intervention through opting out or intentionally misrepresenting your relation. So there's this glorified history of star assignation and this more subtle move among some to refuse the representational act. So let's fast forward. So this is, you know, there's the history. Let's fast forward to 2017. I don't know if people have read about this in the New York Times, but there's this amusing hiccup that happened with the production of the 2017 Michelin Guide in France. It seems that the editors of the guide confused two similarly named restaurants in France that were about 120 kilometers apart. One was a roadside bistro with a part-time cook and a working-class clientele. The other, a decidedly upper-class restaurant with two dining rooms, a terrace, and a history of appealing in the Michelin Guide. There they are. The first one charges about $12 for an all-you-can-eat buffet. The second one, you couldn't even spend about $12 to get an appetizer. Right? And of course, the star that was meant for the latter one was given to the first one. Right? It was a mistake that happened online for a week. But again, these assignations of value and these representations have very material effects. So the error was quickly fixed. The result had all of these effects on these readers who suddenly started to go out of their way to find the roadside bistro. Right? They went out of their way and they drove up to the top. Yeah. And it overwhelmed the owner, who had a part-time chef. Right, and it was a. They say that the majority of the clientele in there are wearing those reflective vests because they're the road workers that would go there because it's equivalent of $12 to get an all-you-can-eat buffet. So, materially though, they're very different. It's the confected markers that failed Michelin. Their names are strikingly similar, and the roads that they are on are also strikingly similar. So the way in which they were named sort of impacted it. But if you went there. Materially, of course, they're very different. Okay, so this mishap had these types of effects even once officially corrected. So as the owner of the roadside bistro observed, I really thought it was a joke, but actually it was real. My phone is ringing all day long until late at night. It's madness. Right? And the effects continued beyond the scope of this one-time misrepresentational event. Connected to other formalized calculations. Because of its newfound fame, people started going there, they started checking in there, like online, on Google, and suddenly, she has a 4.8 rating out of 5 on Google. This restaurant that had never had an online presence, people start going there because of the misrecognized or the misappropriation of the star. They check in and they start rating the restaurant on Google. So suddenly it's 4.8. She's gone from a 1 on the 3-point scale to a 4.8 out of 5. Like, that's pretty great. So it hardly had an online presence at all. And then it starts to affect the daily practices, which affects new representation. So what you've got is representation upon representation upon representation. Right? Kind of interesting. Again, we keep coming back to the material effects of this. We've slipped from a mistaken one-star rating to an overwhelmed owner whose reality is madness, to a 4.8 star rating on a 5-point scale, where some restaurants in their ratings are demanding that Michelin reapply the 1 point, their one star, even though it was misassigned, because they think it's only right. So, as I mentioned, I grew up intellectually on Foucault, and this quote is amazing to me. It's rather delightful. I really thought it was a joke, but it was real. It's madness, right? The Foucauldian in me is like, oh yeah, of course. I have in my own work and in my book become kind of obsessed, I think a little bit, with notions of reality, with notions of truth, and with notions of madness or absurdity, particularly when it comes to educational research. So I'm going to return to these notions in a little bit. Maybe absurdity of jokes entangled with truth statements entangled with madness is productive after all, right? But first, let's move towards the second anecdote, which has to do with a similar star rating, but is an effect of the rather robust analytics movement, to think of which we are all a part. So recently, my university has cast its lot with the academic analytics movement. I don't know if it's in use here, but through academic analytics, it affords the opportunity to examine faculty production at multiple levels, across colleges, departments, or even at the individual level. So academic analytics is a company that will search the web for information, but academic analytics is also sort of a movement, right? So you have the company and you have the movement. So through academic analytics, faculty are given a Z-score that is devised through a combination of publication values and grant outputs. How much one is published, where, citation counts, impact factors, and more. Each faculty's Z-score is devised through a comparison against population of other faculty, both within the university and across the country, based on rank and years. So if you're a fourth-year associate professor, you will be measured against other fourth-year, if you're an associate professor who's been there for 4 years at that rank level, you will be measured against other associate professors who have been at that rank level, fourth year, in order to understand your sort of value. So that's academic analytics. Within my university, what's coming is, based on your academic analytic Z score, you will be assigned, you guessed it, a star rating. Right, based on their respective comparative value, with 5 stars being an outstanding score. As you move up in rank from assistant to associate to full professor, your ranking and star score changes accordingly. So we might follow the Michelin example. These 1-star faculty are worth the odd visit, but it's the 3-star faculty that are worth a side trip away from one's journey through the program of study. Right? So this, in this way, the absurdity is wonderful, but what I want to keep pointing to is this relational representation. Actually, the logic is quite the same. And it is impacting daily faculty practices, just like it is impacting the poor but wonderfully excited, right, bistro owner who can't keep up with the number of folks coming to her door, nor her online representation. It's real, it's madness. Yeah. Okay, so more ominously, of course, movement up the star rating system brings with it recognition and economic stability. Decline in the star system for faculty calls to question the very faculty's subjecthood. The star ranking simultaneously gives evidence and rationale for intervention. So as a department head, one of my jobs is to evaluate the analytical and star rankings to determine whether or not they are right. And I have no idea what that means. Exactly. An administrator said to me, well, here's what you need to do. Look at the star rating and look at the academic analytics report and measure it up against your gut. Do you feel like the rankings are right? So there's this wonderful notion of representation being squared with affect, right? And as an aside, we have this lovely historian of education, Stephen Tomlinson, at the University of Alabama. I recommend his book. It's called Headmasters. It's about phrenology. I was having this conversation with him, and he, and I don't, you know, he's the historian, said that that's actually how IQ tests, how they measure the validity of IQ tests. They gave students initially in classrooms the IQ test, and then asked the teachers to rank their rosters based on what they felt, who they felt like were the best students, and then they tried to see if IQ tests held together. So isn't it interesting that we have this analytic movement that then comes back to this notion of affect, like which do you feel is right? So as a department head, I'm sort of like, well, do I feel like the rankings are correct? Okay, so of course these contexts are rife with objectified relations inherent in processes of reification, but also particularization. So in order to, those of you who had, you know, your good stats courses, in order to manufacture a Z-score, what do you need? You need both a normalized population or a normalizable population with like values, right, the mean against which data points are valued, and a representationally conflated series of attributes that are common to the population, which would be like the publication, right, values that I talked about before. So there exists in this scenario a series of relational values, the distance between one's data point and the mean, or the standard deviation, right? Relational logic starts to come in. That stand in for what this relation stands in for one's work as a faculty member, and there are related objects through which faculty are known. So thus one could be one's objectified Z-score. representation stands in for you, subjected to an equation that gives select weights to one's quantifiable research outputs. One is, in this instance, the distance between oneself and the populated mean of one's peers. That is, how normal are you, right? It's a normalizing process. One could be a seemingly more qualitative star rating, how one's productivity is categorized within one's institution, right? The joke we all make is, how long before stars are then given colors in addition to numbers? Oh, you're only a 5-star, I'm a 5-gold star, very much, thank you very much. Better luck next year, you'll get the gold along with the star. One is, of course, institutionally recognized as all these things. The tangled mass of Z-scores, star ratings, and individualized publication records that come together in one's thingification, that is, one's objectified relation. So this is the nice thing about Foucault, thing becomes a thing, and thingification becomes like a technical term, right? And I'll try to use it in technical term, but it's hard because you're like that thing, right? But for Foucault, that thing means a series of these relations. So early, it's still early in the adoption process, but here's what my university intends to use these markers for: merit raises, tenure decisions, sabbatical requests, and at the department level, decisions for adding or removing tenure processes. Right? Again, these are not just scores in the abstract. These are going to determine if, for instance, the department gets a new line, a new faculty line. It'll determine the amount of money that comes into your paycheck. As a faculty member, we're on merit-based pay. And as a department head, ostensibly, how well I can make these determinations also impacts my paycheck. Right? So again, presentation leading towards assignments of value with very material results. Okay, so through this assessment process, these relational varies are frozen as objectified things, reified objects to which the passive and the now subjected faculty member must orient and respond. Sometimes we forget this about reification. What happens through part of the process of reification is that subjects, like, take on passive qualities and objects take on active qualities. So you respond to the object, right? All you can do is respond to. So you respond to your 3 stars, or you respond to your Z-score. And the Z-score almost seems to have this agential movement where all you can do is change your material practices to try and increase the Z-score. Okay, so you're subjected then to the relational claims of the Z-score, the star rating, and the publication record. They simultaneously stand in for and act upon the faculty subject. One can also never escape them. They present a complete history stored in databanks and computers. Ostensibly, I can pull up a Z-score, once this gets going, of all the faculty in my department for the past 5 years, right? Get your 5-year sort of Z-score. And here's the interesting thing. The data are always a year removed from present day, because academic analytics has to get historical data. So we are all indeed our histories, right? So your academic analytics Z-score is based on who you were a year ago, right? It's kind of interesting the way in which these things become historical. Within such circumstance of determined subjecthood, what one is, the academic analytics score, the star rating, what is one to become? What one has yet to be? The unknown future that the analytics movement seeks to predict or even preempt. That is, how does one's fixed representation impact what one has yet to be? This, I think, starts to move us into new materialism, because I start thinking about not what one is, this act of being, subjecthood, but what one might become. If you're going to become something, you are no longer closed and discrete, because you'll be other than how you are now, right? So I think this is where new materialism can come in a helpful way. And you'll see it, sometimes it's overdone, but you'll see in the new materialist writings, they don't talk about being, they talk about becoming, right? Again, Foucault's my boy, so I have to say, and so did Foucault. Right, but that's okay. How does one's representations impact what one has yet to be? As I'm going to discuss, these scores and the process that inform them make possible a preemptive mindset, one that encourages moments to preempt something that has yet to take place. And if you haven't read Patricia Clough, I think that's how you say it, it's C-L-O-U-G-H, she's done some really great work on sociological research methods that talk about a logic of preemption. At what point does the institution, does the individual step in to preempt something that hasn't even occurred yet, right? And we can use academic analytics, or you can use star ratings to sort of work through this. Okay. So in the end, this scenario situates faculty representational identity and simultaneously one of reification that I talked about before, and excessive representation. I am not my work, yet my work is more than me, right? I am not any star rating or Z-score, yet they are extensions of me. They represent me and they are comparatively more than me. They stand in for and point to relations that exceed me as a faculty subject. It individualizes even as it massifies. That's what happens. You become individualized to the data point and you become massified to the relation to the population. It's an interesting sort of way in which this happens. It becomes a metaphor-inducing machine, right? You are three stars. You are the academic analytics. And through this metaphor-inducing machine, the analytic process is cast within representational thinking, hence its reliance on the humanist subject for meaning-making. And this makes possible a host of practices and further representations, right? So this is what's interesting. There's a slippage here that I think I find interesting. You produce all these analytics. You might work against the humanist subject, but you fall back into the humanist subject. We talked about this a little bit today, for representation, right? Of course, we have the crisis of representation in cultural theory and inquiry, and it demonstrated the dangerous limits of representational thinking. Representations inevitably fail to fully capture or contain that which they seek to represent. Life is always already excessive, right? You enter the new materialists again. Thus it is that such determinations are built on two limiting subjects, the humanist subject and this mythos of representationalism. And certainly academia is replete with research strategies aimed at creating more complete representations. Inquiry then becomes the technological companion to reification. You know, we talk a lot about the crisis of representation and how it affected inquiry, but I think you really only need to look at the standardized textbooks, right, in qualitative research that are document many of our syllabi that are replete with strategies of interviewing, observing, coding data that are seeking, their reason to be is that they seek to generate more robust representations. Like, my representation is better than your representation, right? And the like. So I think it's, if these texts are any indication, representational thinking, I think, is alive and well, right? Despite the work of many contemporary theorists, some of here at the University of Georgia, who are really doing quite nice work to dismantle representational thinking, or at least put it under some element of crisis. Okay, so those are my two opening anecdotes, bound by representations of value and star ratings. Of course, here's the kicker, right? The Michelin Guide is entirely qualitative. Inspectors visit restaurants in person in order to understand its function, observing and eating multiple times before a star is awarded. So perhaps a comparison might not be fully apt. However, though the Michelin Guides do not rely on Z-scores, they do invoke this relational and representational logic that similarly enables the academic analytics movement. And like the academic analytics movement, Michelin stars extend as representations that exceed their material reality or their material referent. Recall my comment before that the food exceeds the restaurant, right? Restaurateurs then sought to miscalibrate their restaurants. Similarly, representations of faculty work, Z-score, star ratings, and all that, can exceed the material context of the faculty member, becoming more than what might be imaginatively acted. Thus, the Michelin Guides might serve as an example of this easy slippage of qualitative work into an assessment and assertion of value. Also, these two anecdotes, as an aside, may be bound by similar conflations of disbelief, reality, and madness. Take that quote and attribute it to any of my faculty when they started talking about academic analytics, right? They responded to it in words that are quite similar. I thought it was a joke, but actually it was real, right? It's madness, right? Those were our early department meetings, like, oh, you must be joking. You're gonna give me a star rating, you know, is this kindergarten, right? So it must be a joke. Oh, wait, but it's real. But wait, it can't be real because it's mad. Right, so you can see the way in which faculty, and I was in on some of those conversations, making similar claims, are responding in similar ways to the poor bistro owner. So I've come to think of these examples and as those operating from what I call this logic of extraction. Data are represented outside of the material context in which they are formed. That was Michelin's problem, right? The data was outside the actual material context. They was representational. They're extracted from the immediate and meant to be meaningful across time and space. That is, they're not bound by material context. Okay, So these, of course, these extractive practices return to have material impact. The effect of having a particular star rating, if even an incorrect one. Again, it's real, it's madness, it's real madness. It's real in the sense that there are material consequences for such ratings. My paycheck, etc. Mad in the sense that in order for you to operate within it, you have to take on the logic of it, right? You have to operate within its logic systems. So you perhaps imagine where this might go, particularly when it comes to the nature of governing or being governed. One becomes adept at anticipating the effects of the star rating, generating practices aimed at impacting the rating itself rather than the process, activity, or experience the rating is meant to represent. And you probably, you know, all of you can probably see this, where suddenly before faculty are even beginning research projects, they're thinking about the product and where it might be placed, right? Who has a better score? What journal has a better score in terms of acceptance rates and the like? And that then shifts their project. Yeah? much like the people try to figure out all the time what the Michelin agents are looking for in sort of quality food. So they're shifting their menus. Okay. So there are two readings that I've sort of alluded to or worked with that I think bear unpacking in relation to inquiry, work, and governance. And I'm going to give a bit of a sketch, because I do want to leave time for questions as I work through this. But I think it's useful to ask, given these circumstances, what elements are necessary for this logic of extraction to be employed in these ways? What does the logic of extraction ask or require of us? While the first extends from the creation of discrete, knowable subjects, whose actions can be representationally quantified in particular ways, and I might add, in ways that attend to meaning, that is, that draw from a bit of common sense. I become defined as a faculty member, and my actions can be caught up in the analytical net, cobbled together to present a complete picture of who I am and what I do. In this sense, I am my data. Right? The second gets at this notion of disparate bits, so that you see that sort of cobbling together to create the humanist subject. The second gets at these disparate bits and pieces of data to create not the humanist subject, the discrete whole, but what Deleuze talked about as the individual. In distinction from the normalized representation of the individual as discrete, non-reducible, the liberal subject or self, Deleuze gets at this notion of the individual as endlessly divisible, subjected to an infinite array of normalizing data representations. The individual is simultaneously known individually as a unique and immediate intersection of multiple data points, and collectively, the bits and pieces of data that inform a larger normalized population. The individual is then both and. It's simultaneously individualized and massified. And as a result, for Deleuze, as well as for Foucault, the individual is more governable than the humanist subject. So this is where, again, new materialists would come in and say, like, okay, here's the problem. We're becoming more governable as subjects based on these representations and the materiality that comes out of this. This links to Foucault's notion of biopower, right? That I mentioned earlier in our earlier conversation that Foucault, of course, shifts from disciplinary notions of power. You sit in your chair, that was the example I gave, right? And I'll sit you in the chair, right? To biopower, right? Which is actions kind of upon actions. In order to have biopower, you have to have a sense of population. Population is a historical construct, right? We didn't always think culturally in terms of populations. Why do you have to have a sense of population? Because you have to have a comparative value. So, and this is, remember, we're talking here about social science and the like, but the example that I often give is something like, blood pressure, right? You know your blood pressure score and you know what's normal and not normal. Why? Because you know it against the larger population. Yeah? And this is where it's not that it's right or wrong, it's that it's dangerous. Like, I'm happy that we know the generalized population of what's normal in terms of blood pressure.
In terms of blood pressure. Or cholesterol count is another good one. It's probably a better one because they're always coming up like, do we really need to know high versus low cholesterol and that type of thing? You only really know it in terms of what's normal. But population is a historical construct for someone like Foucault. And out of population, you have statistics, right, which allows you to do this comparative value, which Foucault loves to say, remind us, is the etymology of statistics is a science of the state. right? Isn't that kind of interesting? So Foucault's like, oh, that's interesting. We've got a science of the state. We have a notion of population. And now we have processes of normalization, because you understand yourself as an individual and in relation to this larger mass, which is the population, right? And we are governed through both. Okay. So there's this guy Lazzarato. I don't know if people have read him. Lazzarato. He wrote a book called The Indebted Man. He talks about the individual, he talks about it as infinitely divisible, but also as decomposable into partial and modular subjectivities. So you might start to think, as Maya, I'll use myself as an example, as my career arcs, my faculty data deems me meritus, right, worthy of merit pay, promotable, from assistant to associate, soon to full professor, and employable. My data are pieced together with the other data to produce reports for the department, the college, the university. I contribute to the data points of productivity that rationalize my collective and my position collectively. As such, through the analytical machine, I am again individualized and collectivized simultaneously. I'm folded unto myself within and without the cloud of collectivity. For Deleuze, I plug into and am plugged into the subjectivizing machine, right? Deleuze has this notion of machines that you plug into. So out of the academic analytics machine, the faculty individual is born. I like this idea of the machine because I had a lot of weird jobs, but one was as an apprentice to an electrician. I was an electrician's apprentice, which meant basically I got really good at handing tools to the actual electrician, because they wouldn't let me hear anything. But one thing you learn about is this idea of electricity moving in circles, right? And so if you wanted to plug in, it would increase the circle. You plug in here and it completes the circle. And if you break the circle, then it stops, right? Or you get zapped. Well, this is for me an interesting way in which Deleuze talks about the sort of subjectivizing machine. You have these machines and you plug into them and you become extensions of them even as you enact the machine. Right, so it's a very interesting notion that I think is quite useful from Deleuze's point of view. So this production of the individual extends as a government of things. Get back to what my title was: the thingification of relational possibility and probability. Both the possible and the probable take on material import through calculation. And it releases any epistemological reliance on this liberal subject to maintain the normalized status quo. It's as though the liberal subject that, to which we adhere so dearly could fall away, and you still would continue to be governed. You couldn't do that necessarily with disciplinary power because you needed the liberal subject to sit in the chair, right? So now the liberal subject can sort of fall away. The individual is to be managed, relationally understood, as a collective public, and Patricia Clough has this great quote, which talks about the publics as a circulation of ways of doing things, ways of being, opinion addressed to an audience. I just love the sort of tilt of phrasing that the humanities person loves that. Thus it is that the collectively relational value of the individual as public makes possible governance on onto-epistemological levels. The entanglement of knowing with being, right? That's sort of a classic neo-materialist move, whereas before you had epistemology, ways of knowing, right? It's different than ontology, ways of being. You bring them together to say ways of knowing are ways of being and ways of becoming. Yeah? Now this is a hard thing to hold on to because for me anyways, culturally, I understand them differently. And this often is a way to slip back into it. So we should be skeptical when we see onto epistemology just sort of like spewed into an article or something, but we should really take seriously what that means. She actually talks about ethical onto epistemology. Right, so she brings them all together. So that's something for decided, but people use Barad often talk about that. So the collectively relational value of the individual, now as public, makes possible governance on this onto-epistemological level, whereas governance from the perspective of reification that I talked about before hinged on epistemological controls via representational. A relational government of things blurs the distinction between knowing and becoming, integrating governing effects into all elements of life, including the affective. So in this way, the governing state is no longer primarily engaged with elements of law, for instance, but instead becomes organized around administrative function of all elements of data, including the administration of affective states. Indeed, educational inquiry, I think, plays no small role in this. You can often talk to faculty that are like, all I do now is administer, right? I'm administering tests, or I'm administering students through a program of study, or I'm administering whatever. That's the faculty work now. It's also the institutional work. You talk to administrators, and they say leadership is about administration in these ways, and they're not always happy about it. So many of us feel this. You've seen it, and people have talked about administrating the affective state, how sort of the affective notion of population stress, where everyone's sort of stressed out and freaked out, and so as a result, we become increasingly interested in issues of security in particular ways. We close in, right? This becomes, for Foucault and Deleuze and others, an element of governmentality, right? It makes possible select things, ways for us to be governed differently. So the individual is eminently governable, manipulated through interaction within material environments. In this way, analytics, as a technology of governmentality, incites the individual to establish an environment that forces him or her to react in one way instead of another. So you start to shape your own environment, right? That aligns with these processes of normalization. I adjust, create an environment that makes my individuation all the more remarkable and engrossing. No longer external to the created governmental environment or context. My activities contribute to the context through which I'm individualized and generatively massified. I become with and as the governing process. Right, that's sort of the materialist term. So it would be a mistake to characterize the individual and the relations that produce the individual as thing as amaterial or immaterial to processes of governing. They are actually, the relations in which you're immersed are profoundly material, extending as they do from actions, flows, intensities that manifest in what has traditionally been known as the material world. So this remains a very point of data, relations, etc., as not bound by representation. They're generatively material. Right? We're out of position. So as a result, you might, in order to engage with them, this notion of the individual and its effects, we need newly productive disruptions to this logic of preemption that play a significant role in the government of things, particularly encountered in the higher education educational inquiry. So you can start to get the notion of this idea of disruption. Deleuze talks about wanting to make things stutter, right? And wanting to make normalized flow stutter. And I ask in my book and elsewhere, what does it mean to make methodological practice stutter? So often we work, and I think at least I do in my own classes and with colleagues and students, to make methodological practice run smoothly, right? That's my job. I need to govern you through that sort of process. So planning for uncertainty, then, means that populations must be coded, described, valued, and quantified. This is the logic of preemption. It's strikingly apparent in higher education, given the increase in management culture that seeks to enable, regulate, and ultimately govern the contemporary academic culture. And it activates security mechanisms seeking to manifest some desired and quantifiable, and even preempt possible futures. I really think this idea of preempting of something that hasn't yet occurred is really interesting, because what's the logic that governs the preemption at that point? Governing through a logic of preemption does not seek to operate on a necessary binary of normal or deviant, with the expectation being that governing seeks to intervene in the manifestation of the deviant. And this is, again, Patricia Clough and pulling from her here, where she says, governance is less interested in the distinction between the normal and the abnormal, but in a comparison of normalities. So just how normal are you, distributively speaking? That binary drops. So it's not about are you deviant and are you normal, it's how normal are you. So normalization has no reference to the deviant anymore. It's a continuing process of normalization. Thus it is that the normalization of populations occur through self-referential and relational processes. Normalization feeds itself and doesn't need an opposite for its existence. As a seemingly benign example, the field of education and generally, and educational research more specifically, is replete with promising practices. Probably seen this. Promising practices, activities that are shown to be normatively generative, producing effects that works to extend and govern select contexts. The process of the normalization continues without the referent of the abnormal or deviant, which is rare that you hear promise-less practices, right, which would be the opposite. So you start to have these sort of processes of normalization. Deleuze talks about this as a over and over again disforming cast, which I really like. So the cast shifts and changes with the time. So you're I'm a visual person, imagine on your arm, it's here, and then it self-deforms to here, and then it self-deforms to here, not in terms of what's right or wrong or deviant, but the process of normalization of creating the arm. Okay, So part of this comparison of normalities extends from a logic of preemption. So we've got the logic of extraction, and then we've got the creation of individual, which gives way to a logic of preemption, which is a governing force aimed to not distinctly intervene and change the course of something, but to, as Deleuze notes, modulate. So I got really frustrated as I was working through my book, because I want educational research and inquiry to intervene, that is, enter into and change the direction of. And Deleuze, I think, would laugh and be like, all it can do is modulate. Like a radio wave, processes of normalization flow, bending and changing in form, until aligned into a normalized pattern to produce sound, a recognized or recognizable frequency. In similar fashion, individuals and the populations of which they are a part modulate. They become undulatory in orbit, and they become a continuous network. Right? So once you shift out of the humanist subject, you can read this about some as like a productive loss, you start to move into these processes of modulation. So through our normalized research then, we are not given the opportunity to intervene, that is interrupt, but rather only to modulate, to shift ever so slightly within the bounds of normalization. So for faculty, you can be a deviation from the norm, but only a few standard or standardized deviations from the norm. If you're too far afield, your work can't be recognized. So we often talk about faculty work. What does it mean if someone wants to do a performance piece, right? In education, right? Arts-based piece in education. Something that is seen analytically too far afield to be governed in such an extent that it can be given a Z, you know, it can be given a score that will go into the Z score. What do we do with something? So again, you can be, you have to be normal in order to be recognized. You can't be too far afield. So some folks have started talking about academics and academic work as a target population, right? The intersection of multiple processes and practices and importantly calculations that through the density of their relation create or outline an academic subject. So this subject is never complete, it never fully becomes a thing. Unlike the humanist subject, there is no a priori subject. There's nothing before calculation. I'm going to skip a little bit ahead, but if you look at one thing about the individual is it's never complete, right? It's because it's continuing, it's feeding. There's perpetual training is the modulating norm. If we look at faculty practices, academic practices, there are an endless array of grant workshops and assessment trainings that one can continue through. The faculty individual and the field modulate. In order to know about academic analytics, you had to go to an 8-hour training, which is as much training of the mind as it is pushing the right buttons, right? To think along those sort of lines. So the process that happens is this idea of trying to preempt future activities to warn of the failure to live to my faculty existence, right? At what point do you have to self-regulate? And if you're a graduate student, I remember being a graduate student, and I often was subtly told, if you study this, you might not get a job. Right, so you start suddenly studying that. If you do these methodologies, then you might not have currency on the field, you might not need a job, right? You get in, you start to self-modulate, you want to get tenure, right? Then you want to become full, and you also want to become known on the world stage, I guess. If you're an introvert like me, you're like, I want to have practices work, everyone just leave me alone. So what do we make of all of this? Well, both extractive and relational logics inform governing practices. Consequently, these newly material theorizations employ a logic of relations that are not inherently freeing or subversive. This is my critique of the new materialists. This doesn't mean they're not useful, it's just that they're dangerous in particular ways. What they do offer is the notion of excessive possibility, that relations exceed their calculation, and mistakes happen, miscalculations happen. So there are ways that we replicate this within our research, particularly within something like the interview. But I'm also interested in productive miscalculations. Maybe we need to miscalculate ourselves. And I'm interested in the shift that happens with extractive logic. So I just have some examples. I love this, that Certeau, who's another person, he wrote The Practice of Everyday Life. If you haven't read it, it's pretty good. I like this idea. When someone asked him about the meaning of the sonata, it is said Beethoven merely played it over. So you might read this as resisting extraction. Right? What does this mean? You just play it, right? Again and again. So I'm wondering about maybe we need similar spontaneity in our methodological We need to wander, right? And we need to refuse this extraction, refuse this idea of something being cut away. So Toa went on to write that what cannot be uprooted remains by definition outside of research, right, the thing that you can't uproot. And so I'm interested in this notion of extraction, which of course means this idea of drawing something out. But it also means to get out by force. I think sometimes we forget the force of extraction, particularly when we do something like sit down with an interview and force somebody to sort of commodify what it is that they have to say, to commodify their experience. So I'll zip through this, and we can talk about this more because I don't want to be long. But if you look at the standard interview, you can see this process of extraction happening as well as a process potentially of moving someone into individuation. Where you move from the actual interview experience, to which becomes a linguistic one because it's orally, and then it's recorded, which becomes a data file, then it's transcribed, which becomes a text, then it's coded, right? So you're extracting it from that, and then it's maybe re-rendered in your paper. See how you become removed from the actual experience itself, which is what got Michelin in so much trouble. They got so far away from the experience of the agent, right, that all of a sudden they're giving a start to the wrong place. So what then does it do? Does it mean to miscalculate something? And I'm kind of ending there because that's what I'm trying to figure out right now, and I'm interested in your perspectives on it. I mentioned one of the other areas that I'm interested in is critical geography. I was talking about this earlier, and there are all these ways in which architects anticipate the needs of whoever's going to be in there, and they become miscalculated, they become sort of these mistakes that we don't look to. The example I gave was I did a study of a building, and they had these, they wanted to increase academic activity. So they put everybody's, actually it's more, they made it to a U, right? Imagine a U like this. And here were classrooms, and here were faculty offices. And if you talk to the architects, I looked at the architectural note, they had this vision that people would spill out of the classrooms and make their way to the offices of faculty to continue the conversation. In order to help that, they put these giant windows in all the faculty office doors, so they'd know if they were there or not. And what the faculty do, as soon as they moved in, they covered the windows. Because they actually didn't want that activity, they wanted it to happen differently. Now, you can read that as a miscalculation, but it's also playing into a norm, right? See, it's a normalized process, because as I mentioned earlier, my training is to be by myself, close the door, thank you very much, and sit with my computer, or my books, or my data, right? So once you, so they couldn't anticipate it in that way, but the entire building, this was in 1950, was built with that in mind, right? So you have all these different miscalculations. You can think about the way in which this room makes possible select educational moments, but precludes others, right? I'm assuming those are attached to the floor. So people like me who come in here and want to do group work, you're like, oh, sugar, honey, iced tea, right? I can't get people into these different places. And this is my front, right? This is where I am. So you can start to see the way in which the material of it. I talked about it the other way. What seemed like an abstraction becomes a material object. The way the materialness of everyday life plays out to these extractions, right? Such that what you thought was something just in theory, how do we teach, right? Has severe implications on the buildings. People put thought into this, right? They love the technology. They love all of these different things. And I have another example that comes from the interview where we tried to think through interviews differently. So we started walking interviews, I guess. I think in the UK maybe they call it bumbling, where you go for a walk, right? And we would wear lapel mics and go and get lost. And what does it mean to get lost in thought versus lost on the trail in the arboretum? Because my training around the interview was dull and boring. I mean, I would say that even with Gretchen Rossman. I was meant to get rid of distraction. Sit in a room where the person is comfortable, right? Talk to them as mine. That distractions took away as opposed to being productive. Right? So these are the types of miscalculations, mistakes that I'm sort of interested in. And I guess I'll end there. Happy to entertain any questions.
Well, I'm curious about the relation between miscalculation and governance.
Yeah. So what are you curious about? With?
Well, I mean, on one side, it feels like the notion that we're in the process of becoming constantly modulating adaptation, yeah. and then comparison to the norm, and that enables some sort of governance. Then we have this, you know, then we have this thing, this calculation, yeah. Right? So, how do they relate? And I mean, what's the administrative take on that?
So for someone like Foucault, you are never not governed. So the goal is not to be not governed. For him, the goal is to be governed differently. He has this quote, something like, the goal is to be governed differently, or at least not like that. Right? Because when you become governed differently, then you open up possibilities that you have yet to preempt. So I think that's where miscalculation can come in. The goal, or that the delightful happening of miscalculation, is not that suddenly you're outside of governance, because that doesn't happen. That's the thing with critical materialism. You're in it. You're entangled in it. The thing is that you might be governed differently, and we don't yet know what that is. And there might be this line of flight that you can follow to sort of see how it happens. Deleuze talked about this as sort of territorialization and deterritorialization, and then reterritorialization. So you're governed. It's like, you're neoliberal. It's not that you're not neoliberal. You're going to step out of neoliberalism. It's not like in this culture you're going to step out of capitalism. You can still be critical within it and see how it can activate and articulate differently. So that's how I think that sort of miscalculation, I think it's a losing game to see if it's just going to get you outside of it.
I'm thinking about it in terms of the dissertation. Right?
Yeah.
So the dissertation is a form of governance. And yet, it seems to me that this form of inquiry and miscalculations is the potential for continuing. You're never going to actually find anything. And we have a whole thing called the finder's journey.
Yeah.
And then conclusions and implications. But under this particular way, it made me think about, what's the use of a dissertation?
Right? And which is, as a historical artifact, it's shifted and changed, right? It used to be a giant lit review. The dissertation is so interesting, because we have the standard 5-chapter dissertation as well at UA. So I've kind of, when talking to students that are into this type of thing, I'm like, listen, do the 5 chapters, because you have to learn it in order to critique it. But maybe you do some interchapters, some creative sort of interludes, where you try to work something out, these sort of interstices in normative form. Can you create, what would that look like? Because the thing is, even as I nod this, I want the students to graduate, I want the grad school to, as an aside, we do a lot of things in graduate education that we know aren't sort of educationally healthy. It's interesting that we have the dissertation that's meant to stand in for your graduate student's experience, that we don't have collaborative dissertations. Some places are starting to. UMass Amherst are starting to have collaborative dissertations. Even though we know that actually inquiry projects in collaboration are actually quite healthy. And they produce different types of data than the individuals who are sitting on their own. So what are the ways that we can start to sort of massage that, to have a sort of mistaken collaboration? I don't know. No, we have so many administrative functions to get away from collaboration. You guys use turn it in here. Just say people turn it in, is that thing, we'll see if someone plagiarizes.
Yeah.
You don't, they do it, and there's a movement in graduate school, where I am, to ask that every dissertation go through turn it in. And so I'm thinking, oh my gosh, this is a PhD student we're talking about here, and we're worried about plate. I mean, what has to happen for that to make sense? Well, of course. I mean, all it is push this in this button. Well, you run a lit review through something like turn it in, and you get a lot of hits, right? So there's an administrative function that goes into this notion of the individual. You have to stand on your own 2 feet. Happens with faculty. It's better to have a solo piece, right, as you move through tenure. So we sort of dissuade collaboration. So there are all these things that happen in administrative function.
I'm just curious to know how Vygotsky pulls into this. They're friendly, I guess.
Vygotsky is friendly? Is there a reason?
Friendly to the new materialists.
Yeah, I would think so, but I haven't seen a lot of people using Vygotsky.
Yeah,
this is an excellent point.
Yeah.
People are grabbing onto Deleuze right now, and I think we need to be skeptical. I think there's so much good work out there on new materialism. But your colleague, Betty St. Pierre, was writing about Deleuze in like 92 or something. Like, what is it about this sort of, someone called it the Deleuze deluge, right? This sort of like everybody's grabbing onto this guy. And there's the Deleuze conference, which is amazing, but there's something, what is it that, here's the question we can pull from Derrida. Can you think of new materialism, or can you use new materialism and not think of Deleuze? Right? I mean, that's maybe an interesting question. Maybe Vygotsky comes to that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And can you talk a little bit more about how you're thinking of thing theory specifically? You did use the term.
Yeah, so thing theory, which admittedly I don't know a ton about, but Bennett's work on thingification and thing theory is this idea that there's a vibrancy to matter, and that so things resonate. It's different. There's also, I should say, as an aside, there's thing theory that's in theoretical physics that I know absolutely nothing about. So I can't speak to it in that way, but I will say that, you know, Barad was a physicist, he still is a physicist, so it's interesting these connections that happen. So you can talk, there's two ways to talk about the production of things that I know of. One is reification, and that's a type of thingification. You take a relation and you produce it into a thing that can then become commodified. That's like neo-Marxist, right? And it can circulate. And that's what I was talking about before, where I talked about how objects become subjects. Relations become objects, objects become subjects, and the subject, the individual subject, becomes objectified, or it becomes in objective relation to that happening. So that's one way to sort of start thinking about it, and that relies on discrete individuals, or human subjects and objects. The other way to think about thing theory, thingification, is in relation to this governance, which that things are not objects, things are relations. And once you start thinking about things in relations, then things matter in different ways. So you can't separate out an idea from a chair, right? An idea of a chair from the chair, which is like maybe Schopenhauer or other folks would start to do that. You can't make those distinctions. There is no ideation of the ideal and the material. So that actually what the thing does is it brings those two in productive relationship. You also, things are always in intra-action, as opposed to inter. You've probably seen this a lot in new materialism. So inter, the prefix inter, means between. Intra means within, right? So if you think that things can be between, then you have to have two discrete objects. If you think things are within, then you're starting to talk about entanglement. So things themselves are the entanglement. There is a lot about where people start to make connections with the thing theory that happens within theoretical physics, but I can't go there.
So this is along the lines of the second example that you gave, but Bill Brown writes about the ways in which he's talking about how things are not yet objects, so they're underdetermined and understudied. So there's possibility in the way that he talks about the ways in which objects are tired of us, and things have not been studied in the same way. The danger, of course, is once you start to study a thing, it becomes an object, so that tension of how we remain in that space of the thing without it turning into an object is really difficult, but I think a productive way to think about this miscalculation.
Yeah, that's good. I mean, that idea of something becoming an object once you start studying it, is Sotot's notion, once you uproot it from the relations, then it becomes an object, and then it becomes governed by your study. And that's what I do. I mean, we have to think about this in educational research. What happens when we study classrooms? What happens when we study faculty workplaces? We produce them in this way. That's useful for me to think about.
I just want to thank, if you join with me, to thank Aaron. We really appreciate your help.
Thank you.